In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. My brothers and sisters, we've gathered to pray the funeral mass for the late Mary Josephine, and we're once more in this mass now commending her soul to the care of Almighty God, and we're asking that great gift, that all the promises of her baptism will be realized for her, that is, a place among the saints in glory. It's a tremendous honor to be able to turn to the Almighty, who has brought this world into being, who has breathed creation into being, so to speak, that we can turn to that God and say to him, count our loved ones among your saints and those nearest to your heart and in life with the Trinity for eternity. So that's what we're doing within the Mass itself today. And we have all the promises of the Eucharist with us as well today with the celebration of the funeral Mass. And we're praying for all those who grieve for passing and all those who are extended family members. So once more, on behalf of the parish here and the neighbouring parish as well, to all the family, we extend our sympathies to all of you at this particular time. So she's gone then to join her parents, her family members who've gone before in the journey of life. So the starting now, my brothers and sisters, we'll call to mind our own weaknesses and we ask for God's pardon. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done, what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask Blessed Mary, the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. We turn to God then in the opening prayer. God, you have called your daughter Joseph from this life. Father of mercy, fulfill our faith and hope in you, and lead us safely home to heaven to be happy with you forever. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. We sit now for the scripture readings. First reading now from Ecclesiastes. The psalm then will be, the Lord is my shepherd. And then the second reading, Paul to the letters to the Philippians.
First reading, a reading from the book of Ecclesiastes. For everything there is a season, and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born, and a time to die. A time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill, and a time to heal. A time to break down, and a time to build up. A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek, and a time to lose. A time to keep, and a time to cast away. A time to rend, and a time to sow. A time to keep silence, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time for peace. God had made everything beautiful in its time. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
Second reading, a reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. For us, our homeland is in heaven, and from heaven comes the Saviour we are waiting for, the Lord Jesus Christ. And he will transfigure these wretched bodies of ours into copies of his glorious body. He will do that by the same power with which he can subdue the whole universe. The word of the Lord.
Lord be with you. It's a reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God still and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. If there were not, I should have told you. I am going now to prepare a place for you, and after I have gone and prepared you a place, I shall return to take you with me so that where I am, you may be too. You know the way to the place where I am going." And Thomas said, "Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" And Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Just sit for a few moments, please. Just a few moments of reflection. The name Sheehan is very much associated with Limerick, and Cork, and Kerry. They were the southwest part of the country. Sheehan. In Irish, of course, you know yourselves, Oshiacon. Meaning what? Peace. So a nice name when you think of it, what the name means, peace. And you could say, when you make it, put it into the human flesh, it's about a person, the peaceful one. It's a nice description, isn't it? The peaceful one. It's a big name to live up to. Quite demanding, but it is there. If you know what your name means, and then accordingly respond in kind. So the name Sheehan means the peaceful one. And when you think of it, isn't the word first greeting of the risen Saviour, his friends, the apostles and disciples, was what? Peace be with you. And that peace is a special gift of God. It's not that phrase in the scriptures is not just a polite word like hello or hi or something of that nature to them. No, it is a gift from God is coming to them. The peace of God. And that is the gift from on high, the gift of God's Spirit, the gift of Jesus to the apostles, peacefulness. And you could break it down into two words, two further dimensions. We'll say the word peace can be given wings. And they can be broken down into the idea of inner calm and serenity. You might say, should they both be the same? Well, you could argue along those lines. But I think inner calm refers to the inside of a person. They have the peacefulness within. And on the other hand, serenity might be the outward appearance. You might say about somebody, oh, they've got a very serene appearance. But the same person may have been within, they maybe have all sorts of trials going on, disturbances of one kind or another, and people can fake it, they can fake serenity. They look very composed and things like that. But their inner world is in turmoil. But where the gift of true peace comes is that you've got both inner calm and you've got serenity. Inner calm within yourself, the outward expression of that of serenity. So they're both linked and it's all under the umbrella of peace and peacefulness. The gift of God and so forth. So then, believe it or not, and some of you may know this, some of you may have in your own home, the coat of arms of the Sheehans. And at the heart of the coat of arms of the Sheehans is what? and we call it the crest. And believe it or not, what's in there? A silver dove holding an olive branch in its beak. Again, where does that come from? We have the images there of the dove, the Holy Spirit. And further back in the Bible, you have the Noah story and so forth, and the bird returning with the olive branch in its beak. Peacefulness, doesn't it? The silver dove with a branch in its beak. I couldn't but help on the way in. Some of the cars there have what? A little bit of forest bush placed on the windscreen there, outside there. A kind of springtime, the forest bush, new life, colour, and so forth. And you could say, but that could replace the olive branch in the silver dove's mouth, a beak within itself. A great image of peacefulness, isn't it? Because for so many of the crests that appear on these medieval coats of arms, there are these kind of things of war, swords and all sorts of stuff, knives and whatnot, and things of weapons of war often like that. Seldom enough do you get a crest which speaks of peace. The silver dove, and within its beak, the olive branch. There's no case here today, the first, little bit of forest bush and things like that. So that is profound. Now, on the other hand, the name Mulvihill is what? A devotee or a servant of who? Saint Michael the Archangel. Another biblical reference, you see. Mulvihill, again, where are their origins? On the left bank of the Shannon, up there in Roscommon. And they spread all over the county then when they were scattered. So a very old name as well, from the Midlands, you could say, that's where the family were. And devotees are servants of Saint Michael, is the meaning of the word Mulvihill. So it's a nice name as well, and so forth. Now sometimes on their cross, you find in the medieval coats of arms, sometimes you will get a motto, but not always. Sometimes mottos are given, and more times they're not given. I think if I'm correct about the Mulvihill one, it is to do with heart and home. The idea of the importance of the heart where the fire is, and the home itself. The two things are so important in its structure, the motto, and so forth. So here today then, my brothers and sisters, we're commending Josephine. Yourself may think of her as, you know, in a special way, your own memories and so forth. And remember, as the, with carrying the name Mulvihill and Sheehan, both connected with scriptures, those there, there's a lot there. So we're asking then in heaven today that she be counted among the saints in glory, and that she be at peace with everyone and with and your family as well. Accept the gift of, let's say, for life, what she did while she walked this world. Now the family yourself will be saying a few words more now when Mass finishes and we have done the blessings and so forth. The family will say a few, you'll say a few words of your own thanks and appreciation and what your mother meant to all of you. Having said that, now my little sisters, we're ready for the prayers of the faithful. So those with the prayers of the faithful now can come forward. God the Almighty Father raised Christ his Son from the dead. With confidence, we ask him to save all his people, living and dead.
We pray for her wonderful carers, the district nurses, Alice Moore and Evelyn Sweeney, Dr. Ashley and Dr. Buckley, and the team at the Ivy Clinic, the consultants, doctors, and all the staff of University Hospital Kerry, all of whom looked after our grandma so lovingly, ensured her comfort, and afforded her great kindness in her final days. God bless them in their daily work. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For all those assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us, that they may have the reward of their goodness. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us.
For those who may be worried or anxious at this time, that they may trust in God to care for them in all their needs. Lord, hear us.
Lord, graciously hear us. Heavenly Father, these are some of our prayers and petitions to you. We ask a tournament of blessings. We make our prayer for Christ our Lord. Amen. Now the gifts are brought to the altar. pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we humbly present to you the sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant, we beseech your mercy that she who did not doubt your Son to be a loving Saviour may find in him a merciful Judge who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For as one alone he accepted death, so that we might all escape from dying. As one man he chose to die, so that we, in your sight, we all might live forever. And so in company with the choirs of angels, we praise you and with joy we proclaim. Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Let us kneel now for the Eucharistic prayer. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to the disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partake of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, dear Francis our Pope, Raymond our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember your servant Mary Josephine, whom you have called today from this world to yourself. Grant that she who is united with her Son in death like his, may also be one with him in his resurrection. Remember also our other brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed Apostle and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be coursed to eternal life, may praise and glorify through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. We stand now, we pray, in the words that Jesus gave us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we wait the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant our peace and unity in accordance with your will, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, who take away the sins of the world, grant us peace. May the receiving of your body and blood, Lord Jesus Christ, not bring me to judgment and condemnation, but through your loving mercy before me, protection in mind and body, and a healing remedy. Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy to enter my roof, but I say the word and my soul shall be healed. Now Mary will read the communion reflection. We will then bring the Mass to an end with the final prayers and the final commendation. Once that's over, then the family will say words of thanks and appreciation to you all.
This reflection was given to Sean by his friend Father Gill in Morden in Surrey, and it's entitled, Life Must Go On. One soul goes out through the gateways of death, another arrives and draws in his first breath. One is brought forth to the light of the day, one spirit enters and one slips away. One heart stops working and one starts to beat, one life beginning, another complete. Some weep for joy at the wonder of birth. Some shed their tears on the unyielding earth. Grief seems to freeze up the springs of desire. The dawn has no glory, the sunset no fire. Stunned with bereavement, we hear no glad song, and yet this is happening all the day long. And life must go on, for God takes and God gives. Our loved ones must go, but our memory lives. Hearts may be broken, the dearest thing gone, but time stops for no man, and life must go on.
Thanks. The posthuman prayer. Lord God, your Son left us in the sacrament of his body, food for the journey. Mercifully grant that, strengthened by it, our sister Mary Josephine may come to the eternal table of Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. We now pray the prayers of farewell and of commendation. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express our affection for her, may it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. We'll now bless the remains of the holy water, and we'll use the incense to remind her both her baptism and her confirmation. And through these sacraments of initiation, she came by adoption to be a sister of Jesus Christ. Going with the gestures are the words, Saints of God, come to her aid, hasten to meet her, angels of the Lord, receive her soul, present her to God the Most High. May Christ, who called you, take it to himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham, receive her soul, present her to God the Most High. May Christ, who called you, take himself. May angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham, and eternal rest grant unto you, O Lord, and the perpetual light shine upon her. Receive her soul and present it to God the Most High. And the prayer of commendation then. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our sister, in the sure and certain hope that he gave with all who have died in Christ. She will rise at him on the last day. We give you thanks for the blessings which you bestowed upon her in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with the assurance of faith until we all meet in Christ and with you and with our sister forever. In peace, then, let us take our sister to her place of rest. May the choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham, and while Lazarus is born no longer, may you find eternal rest. I will conclude on that great promise of the New Testament and the Scriptures. I am the resurrection life, says the Lord. Whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Amen. Now I invite the family to say a few words of thanks and appreciation.
Good morning, everyone. I am Josie's oldest child, Pat, and have been chosen to speak about Mum, although some of you know as Grandma, Great-Grandma, Josie, or even Jose. Mum was born in Asdee East in 1936 into a lovely, close-knit family and community. She moved to England in the mid-1950s and settled in North London. One fateful day, soon after arriving in England, she attended a dance at St. Peter and Paul's Parish Hall in Clerkenwell, where Dad was the MC. Because she was there early, our Dad thought she was the band leader's daughter and asked her for a dance. They had a fabulous time dancing the night away, and then after about four dances, Dad asked her if he could see her on the Wednesday, but she said no. He then went back after some encouraging words from his friends and asked if he could walk her home that evening, and she said yes. She thought he had a girlfriend and was just looking for somebody to dance with on the Wednesday. Mum and Dad then married in the same church where they met and lived in North London. And then I was born the following year. 18 months later, we were joined by Maria. We moved to Carshalton, and a bit later, were joined by our brother John. Mum was the kindest, gentlest soul who everyone loved, and nobody ever said a bad word about. Our friends and family loved visiting, as she would always feed them, and like her mother Mary, she was an amazing cook. Some loved her handmade crinkle-cut chips, her lemon meringue pie, but I always remember her lamb broth with pearl barley. Mum was also very determined that we made the most of our education, as she loved school, but had to leave age 14 as they were unable to afford it. When I was younger, I would much prefer to stay home with Mum rather than go to school, but there was no chance she would allow us to take a day off sick. God and the church were another important part of Mum's life, and we all had to be very neatly turned out and well behaved during Mass. I remember when I was an altar boy, Mum would be watching me like a hawk, and if I was fidgeting too much or not paying full attention, she would give me some feedback about it afterwards. The thing is, we would never want to disappoint her in any way, shape, or form. We have now come full circle, and she came back to her beloved Asdee East in the early 2000s. And on Monday the 4th of March, she passed away peacefully, surrounded by family and friends. She had been suffering with ill health for a few years, but she never complained. One thing she always said to us was, complaining won't change anything, so just get on with it. And she lived up to that herself. She was the most wonderful mother who loved us with all her heart. But she was also an amazing wife, grandmother, great-grandmother, second mother to a number of friends and relations, and of course, a loyal friend. When I was 18, a friend of mine, who was a week younger than me, died in a motorbike accident. And I remember the priest explaining his early death by saying that God has a plan for us all to complete, and some complete it sooner than others. In Mum's case, God knew she was able to undertake numerous tasks and only stopped giving them to her when he could see she couldn't do any more. We will miss her with all our hearts, but every one of us has been blessed and our lives enriched by knowing her, whether that was for a few days, weeks, or months, or in some cases, our entire lives. We hope she is happy now in heaven and spending time with our Nan, Mary Mulvihill, and our uncles Paddy and Mike. Thank you.
Amen.